Hi, folks. Will from MinIO here, and today I'm talking with Klaus Post, who is our Erasure Code Specialist here at MinIO. And Klaus, just wanted to ask you a couple of things. A lot of folks are used to duplication of data to protect against data loss, and we use Erasure Code. What makes Erasure Code better?
So there's a couple of things. The main thing is that for the amount of protection that you get, you really get a lot of value for every extra byte you spend on erasure code, putting an erasure code down, compared to a clean duplicate. So if you have a setup that does like threefold duplication, you have three times amount of data in your system is on your actual disks. So what erasure code allows you to do is have the same level or even better levels of protection, and simply spread out the data on more disks, and still be able to reconstruct the data if any number if two or three drives fail. You can simply reconstruct it, and you don't need to rely on duplicates. Also have the great advantage that you can do consistency checks much easier. Say if you have three duplicates and you lose one of them and the two remaining disagree on what is the actual truth, then you no longer know which one. You can rely on timestamps, but everyone knows that in a distributed system, timestamps are inherently unreliable. So there's a lot of things that splitting your data into more chunks and storing them in more places can actually help you with. And if you did 16 duplicates, then you're kind of in the area where you're really wasting a lot of space just to store a kilobyte of data, right?
So a lot of folks are going to be more familiar with a RAID setup for data replication. So how does MinIO differ from a server with that traditional RAID?
Yeah, so what MinIO does is that when we write data, we start by distributing across different servers. So even if you have 16 drives in the server, there will only ever be one part of the data on each server, which then in turn makes it possible for you to lose even several servers and with many, many drives and still have your data available. So we try to maximize the resiliency of your system by simply distributing it in chunks where when you have a data loss, then you can actually keep operating because we spread out the data in a much more accessible way than if you have all the data for a file on a single server. So that is the main difference between a traditional RAID setup and a distributed MinIO setup.
You mentioned 16 chunks there. I know that Erasure Code, as we've implemented it, has that maximum set size of 16 and a minimum of 4. Four makes sense. You have to have at least some parity there, but why did we max it out at 16?
Yeah, so it's an interesting trade-off. So when you divide your files, what of course has to happen is that when a file is written to MinIO, it has to be written to that number of drives. So even though it would be better from a availability standpoint, having 60 chunks, you also have to write every object or part of an object to 50 drives. So in that respect, there's a minimum where you don't gain much, because with 4, you very quickly accumulate a lot of data, but you only have to write an object to 4 drives, which in terms of small objects can be faster, but for bigger objects you gain more by spreading them out, because you can read from this drive at the same time and simply merge the resulting data back together. So yeah, we said the limit could have been 12 or 20. 16 seems like a nice maximum because having four parity allows you to lose any four of these 16 servers, and you can keep operating as if nothing really happened.
Gotcha. And so you were saying you can lose four of the drives out of the set if you have a parity of four. Is that one of the considerations on the trade-off between your storage efficiency versus your data loss protection?
Are there any other considerations? For sure. Okay. So in overall terms, you need to make a risk assessment. What are your expected failures of drives? Sometimes these numbers can be hard to get from a manufacturer, but also what is the expected downtime of a server? You have to factor these in, so and have a bit of overhead in your calculation. So yeah, that's generally how we tend to recommend have something like 4 and 16 seems like reasonable, unless you have very faulty hardware, because that gives a bit of extra. It can also just for a single operation, you can also have like a network glitch or something that cuts out two servers. Then you're still good to go with the full parity on these systems.
We're talking about how we have a set of 16. You were just saying how, you know, if a glitch took a couple of those servers offline.
Yeah.
That sounds to me like we're taking those 16 data chunks and we're not only putting them on 16 different drives, but those drives could be on any server in the cluster.
Yeah.
And that we're using that to our advantage. I know that, but it does seem like it could be a problem. So how are we mitigating that problem of having the data kind of everywhere?
So what we use is deterministic placement the data. So that means basically we take the name of the object or the key, whatever you prefer to call it, and we from that can actually determine which drives will contain the data. So we don't have to do any lookups in the database or anything for that to fetch any object, because once we see the name of it, we already know where it's placed. So in that respect, we don't have a database that can suddenly become corrupted or something, which results in us not being able to locate the data, because we already know which drives will have the data. On the upload side, we also have a few things. So if you have 16 drives in a set, and when you start the upload, we see we have two drives that are offline. We actually add extra parity, so we still have the four sets of parity that you'd expect in that kind when you upload the object.
So even if you're missing the drive, you still have all the parity.
Yeah, so you aren't writing with reduced redundancy in terms of what you expect, but as long as you have a drive offline, the objects will take a tiny bit more space until you have a chance to replace the drive, and it will be healed back to the new drive that has been put in.
So you were talking about having a set of 16 that with a parity of 4, that's going to give you 12 data and 4 parity blocks. Does that lead to any architectural considerations, whether we're dealing with a large object versus a small object? Because I imagine splitting a small object that many times, I don't know.
Yeah. So for sure, the number of drives you split your objects across does have an impact on small objects, because you are doing more writes, and to get the object back, you have to read the 12 parts back and merge them back together. So for sure, that for small objects, in some setups it does make sense to actually go for maybe say 8 drives in a set, so you have four parity and 4 data. That gives you the same resiliency, but it takes up a bit more space. For small objects, it's not really that important, because you have things like 4K block size on your disk. So whatever you write will always take at least 4 kilobytes. So that's dealing with very, very small objects. Mm-hmm. With large objects, you actually want to split it across multiple drives because it allows you to, or it allows the hardware to do concurrent reads, where it reads from all the disks at the same time and stream the data back from each of it. And all the server that is serving the request has to do is then stitch all from each of the drives together and send it back to the client. So for those, you definitely prefer a larger set size for that. But in general, it also depends on the number of servers. So it's not always completely straightforward what to select there. MinIO tries to find a good set size once you initialize it, and you can override it. But for almost all cases, the defaults will actually be what you want to run.
Gotcha. But you mentioned a couple of things there about streaming stuff back together and reassembling, and also the disk block size of 4K. That sounds to me like maybe using some hardware acceleration might be handy, but we don't do that. And why is that?
Yeah, because we don't have to. So in a long time ago, doing the erasure coding was quite CPU intensive. So you'd actually have a bottleneck where if you ran a software RAID, then your CPU was actually the limitation of your system. Mm. Nowadays, both thanks to new techniques, but also new CPU instructions that have been added, we can actually do it much faster than we can read from basically any drive. We can do it faster than you can transfer over the PCIe bus. So there's no real reason for hardware. Actually, copying the data to some hardware, doing the erasure code and pulling it back will take much, much longer than simply doing it in software. So there's no need for it. Yeah, it's in many cases, it's also good that we don't have any special hardware requirements. We're not selling any card that will make it faster, because you can't sell a card that will make it faster than what it already is. So yeah, we've never seen erasure coding even be more than maybe 1-2% of the overall CPU uses, even using NVMe big files, all that. It's just that fast nowadays. So no need for hardware.
That's great. That's perfect. You know, it just makes everything a lot simpler for everybody. Well, thank you very much for your enlightening discussion here on our erasure code there, Klaus Post. For those of you out there in TV land watching us, I hope you enjoyed our little video. If you'd like to reach out with us, you can use any of the methods you see here on the screen, or you can chat with us directly on slack.min.io, or you can just leave us a comment here on the video. And we'll see you for the next interview. Thanks, Klaus.
Cheers.